David.
Hello, mate.
How are you, fella? Good to see you.
Thank you.
What do you think? Is this a beauty?
This is a classic car. I like this already, actually.
State the obvious, Ed. Of course it's a classic. It's an MG. Now, have you noticed, though, it's got freckles, this car?
Everywhere, all over the place.
All over the place.
Yeah, so we need to... It's a lot of body work. I'm a bit worried about that. So what's it like mechanically?
Well, that's the good news. You will not get greasy hands, fella. These are going to be like hands that your mother will clean dishes with at the end of this. Look at that, fella. I mean, it's perfect. You don't have to do anything in that inside.
It's very nice. It's a little bit dirty.
Yeah, that's all it needs. It just needs a clean round there. Yeah. So, although there's a lot to do on the bodywork, I was hoping to have a deal with you because you see the wheels?
Yeah.
They're pretty nasty, aren't they?
They are pretty unpleasant.
I would love the wire wheels, but I think they cost a fortune. Mm. So what I was thinking is these things here, taking them off and me getting them refurbished.
You get your hands dirty and do some work.
Believe it or not,
it's very, very, very
because of the amount of work you got to do on this, I thought you could do that. No, because I'm going to give you a nasty job now.
What?
I was going to ask you to change this interior because it's so dated. It looks like one of your shirts, fella. It's horrible.
It's rude. Well, I can actually. It's actually quite a nice, easy job because these cars are still really, really popular. It's a real big industry revolving around these things, and there are kits available to change all the interiors.
So you're saying that's an easy job?
Yeah, it's a nice indoor job, quite enjoyable. Actually.
Right. So I'll do the interior, and you do the wheels.
No, you carry on with the wheels. It's a nice job for you, and I'll do this.
Right, Ed, get it fixed, get it looking good. Keys are in the ignition.
Thank you.
And look after it. I want to see you squeeze in it, actually. It's going to be quite funny.
Be a bit interesting.
Go on, fella, here you go. Yay! You've done it. Mate, you look ridiculous.
The MG is quite easy to work on, but you've got to be patient and methodical when working on an old car. Stripping the interior out is a nuts and bolts job. Make sure that you store all the fittings carefully as you'll need all these parts when the interior eventually goes back in.
Now these seats aren't uncomfortable by design, it's because of wear and tear. But luckily with a classic car you often get owner's clubs and that's a fantastic resource. You get loads of good advice but you also get solutions to common problems. As with this one, we actually managed to get a refurb kit for our interior. It comes with foam, seat covers, even comes with instructions. So of course my first job is to get studying.
Now it's a bit of a male characteristic to go at things like a bull in a china shop, but believe me, reading the fitting guide is essential.
Well, the instructions say that I have to take these apart, so it's a couple of screws here and here and also some clips down either side of the bottom of the seat, so it shouldn't be too hard.
Nowadays, car companies have got the manufacture of things like seats down to a fine art. But with a classic car like this, the seats are far more cottage industry. I can imagine scores of men building these by hand at the Cowley Works. They're very fiddly and labour intensive.
Well, I've nearly got my first cover off, but unfortunately the headrest is in the way. And of course, on the instructions, which have been great up till now, there is no headrest. So I'm not entirely sure what to do next, but I think it's just a case of suck it and see.
With the cover off, the headrest can be removed with a pinch of the wrench and a quick pull.
Well, that's going to look great on the car. Now, I'm going to do the backrest first, and I'm only changing the cover because the foam is in really good nick and it's got a good few years left in it.
Tapping the seat back onto the frame keeps it firmly in place for the next stage of the retrim. The old rubber sits on and around the frame, but needs to be fixed with contact adhesive to form a proper bond. It dries quickly and then we're ready for a top tip.
There's quite a handy tip in these instructions. If I take the old plastic bag all this came in, cut a strip out of it, stick it over the top edge of the foam, it makes the whole thing easier to assemble. I can just slip the cover over the backrest. Easy.
It's hard to work with foam. It snags and sticks when you try to fit covers, but with the plastic sitting across the shoulder of the seat, the new cover slides sweetly into place.
And there you go, the backrest for the first seat done. I'm ready to do the base of the seat now. So I've got my new cover, got some Hessian protective stuff, which I'll tell you about later on. And of course I've got some new foam. And that's because the base of the seat takes all the hammering, which is why the other stuff was so uncomfortable. Also got some instructions I better have another look at. Now this Hessian is to protect the foam from the webbing at the base of the seat, because obviously when you're bouncing around, it's actually going to be chafing away and then it will wear into the foam and then ruin your seat. So that stops that from happening.
To get a good fit, turn the bottom seat cover inside out. Place the base on the foam and then turn the corners out. Looks good, but I'm at a bit of a loss as to what to do next. Luckily, I have a plan. A night school course in upholstery would probably have been quite useful with all these fiddly fixings.
Well, that looks pretty factory to me, so I'm quite chuffed with that. All I need now is the backrest and put the two together. I know which one I prefer. I've taken everything off this car that I can, so I really can't delay any further. I now have to attack the paintwork. I've got wet and dry paper for having a go at things like stone chips and small abrasions, and for the really unpleasant stuff, I've got a whole load of power tools. I've got loads to be getting on with, so I really better crack on.
An angle grinder is a pretty crude instrument, so use it very carefully. It'll put deep gouges into the metalwork, which you'll have to fill before paint can go on. So being precise here will save you time later. .600 wet and dry is the perfect way to cut back paint and keep the surface nice and smooth. The stone chips respond really well to this gentle treatment.
Earlier on, I mentioned this car had some pretty bad areas of rust. One of the worst parts of the corrosion is up here on the scuttle panel, and that's why I had to take out the window. But after further inspection, it seems it's only on the surface. So all I'm going to have to do is treat it, put a bit of filler in, and then finish it off with some etch primer. I've removed all the flaky bits of corrosion, and now I can use my rust remedy. Now, what this stuff does is chemically change the iron oxide into a solid, firm material. That way, my filler will definitely adhere. The other great thing about this stuff is it actually prevents rust from reforming on the treated area. Well, that's all the rust sorted out, but it still looks rubbish because of this big dent in the metal. So I'm going to use the filler to build it up. Now, when mixing this stuff up, it's important that you get it right. You need about a golf ball of filler to about a pea of the pink hardener. And of course, the reason it's coloured is to make sure you don't have any streaks, so you know you've got it mixed thoroughly well. And you've got to do it pretty sharpish because it does go off quite quickly.
Don't be tempted to slap the filler on. Use it thinly because any excess will have to be rubbed down again once it's hardened.
You don't want to be too rough with this stuff, because if you remove too much filler, you'll only have to put some more on later.
A dusting of primer is the final stage for this scuttle repair.
I've got a few more repairs like this one to do elsewhere on the car, but once they're all done, it's ready for paint.
Paint won't bind to a surface unless it has something to grip onto. Strange as it seems, I'm using these Scotch pads to put tiny scratches into the surface of the car. The MG is going to be professionally primed and resprayed, which will cost big bucks, but by doing all this prep work now, I'm saving time and money in the body shop. This preparation has taken me hours and hours and hours of hard work. It's almost done, which means one thing. Mr. Brewer knows it's safe to show his face again.
Click here to subscribe.